There is this foolish idea in some areas of modern popular culture that Richard the Lionheart was a great warrior, but bad administrator. This is a ridiculous idea. You can't be a bad administrator and successfully lead a small army against a much larger army in hostile territory. And that's exactly what Richard did. Military historian J.F. Verbruggen explains Richard's competence. He did not rashly try to exploit his success after the Great March of Arsuf and the battle there. He was, in addition, concerned for the personal welfare of his men. He took care to provide for them properly, allowed no unreasonably long marches, imposed strict discipline to protect the whole column of march, supervised the execution of his orders personally, and at the same time was ready for any unforeseen eventuality. This is something that often is overlooked when Richard's decisions during the Third Crusade are considered. Why didn't he pursue the survivors of Saladin's army after Arsuf? Why didn't he attack Jerusalem? Why was he always risking his own life by going to the areas of battle where his troops were most hard-pressed? The truth is that Richard the Lionheart was a stark realist and always made decisions on the basis of ensuring that his army endured. He also was deeply concerned about the welfare of his men, whether in ensuring that the army was properly provisioned or in planning his marches. This is also why he would personally go to those places on the line where his men were most hard-pressed, most in danger of destruction. He would not let them face danger without him. It's no surprise that his men were so devoted to him. Richard was famously approachable. He took every position in the army seriously and wanted all his men to feel confident and supported. He was constantly visiting the various divisions of the army, personally delivering orders and overseeing the condition of the men. He was a very hands-on, involved commander who lived and fought with his troops. Historian John Gillingham summarizes Richard's brilliance as an administrator. Richard won his wars not simply by deeds of prowess on the battlefield, but also by being able to transform the economic resources of the Avannian Empire into military supplies and ensure that these supplies were in the right place at the right time. In other words, by sheer administrative competence. The image of Richard as a knight in armor, good at fighting, but nothing else, is an image based upon a romantic and unrealistic view of war. Campaigns were not won by displays of mindless courage. 12th century warfare, revolving around the control of stone castles and fortified towns, was as precise a discipline as warfare in the Age of Vauban. To master this discipline, a man required many skills, a grasp of military tactics and strategy, the ability to pick good subordinates, and the ability to inspire their confidence and loyalty. Taken as a whole, Richard's record was a remarkable one. In tactics, his march from Acre to Jaffa was a model of its kind, as was the manner in which he exploited efficient reconnaissance in order to drive Philip in utter confusion into Gisors in 1198. In strategy, he showed himself capable of organizing a crusade, planning an attack upon Egypt, and conducting the overall defense of the Avannian Empire. In politics and diplomacy, he was able to outmaneuver Philip by making the crucial alliances with Flanders and Toulouse. In administration, he was ultimately responsible for picking such men as Hubert Walter and Geoffrey Fitzpeter in England, Robert of Thornham in Anjou, Geoffrey de La Celle in Aquitaine, while the case of William FitzRalph as Seneschal of Normandy makes it clear that he did not recklessly dismiss all his father's senior officials out of hand. These justiciars and seneschals not only collected money on Richard's behalf, they also spent it chiefly, as the king did, on war. Efficient administration is not simply a matter of collecting large quantities of money without arousing too much opposition. It is also a matter of spending money effectively, so that the desired end is achieved. In this sense, Richard himself was a fine administrator, who knew the political, diplomatic, and military value of open-handedness.